Behold, and I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will worship with him, and he with me.
Amen.
You want to have some requests?
How about that? Where could I go but to the Lord? Maul's book, and I had the page number there, and I think it's 117. And you know, I went to the doctor's office before I got sick and ended up in the hospital. It's just like the woman that had the issue of blood for 12 years in the Bible. We've exhausted that all we have, and this doctor, that doctor, and I don't seem to be getting any better. So finally, as I was getting ready to leave the doctor's office, he said, we're going to find out exactly what's wrong with you. And I said, doctor, would you have a word of prayer with me? And the doctor put his hands in my hands, and we prayed. And, you know, it's this into agree upon, he'll do it, he'll do it. So nevertheless, it really made the devil mad. We was come out of Hurricane and come up Route 16. As we was coming up through there towards St. Albans, and the car was coming from St. Albans, it was a white car. And it was coming down on the other side, and we was on the right, on the left. Next thing I knew, it looked like a silver bullet in our lane headed directly toward us. And so all I could say was, Bob, Bob, and about that time he veered to the left just a little bit. And do you know that I don't know how that silver car got between our car and that white car? It was just boom. Wow. And I know that it had to be the Lord. It was an angel that did that.
Yeah.
And I mean, it was so split second, it had to be God.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I want to give him praise, honor, and glory this morning. And I got a granddaughter that really, she's got a religious spirit, and I think I've mentioned that before. And she's headed for a lot of trouble. She was raised in church, because you're raised in church does not save you. You got to come through the plan of salvation and through the blood of Jesus Christ. And Pastor Jim's doing better, and I need you all, if you will, pray for my brother Howard. He's got inflammation in his toes. His ankles is a swelling, and when he sings, he loses his breath. And also, I got a sister that's in the hospital. I had the heart cath done. And the next day, Bob got all upset, but there was never anybody there for her when she goes to the hospital. And he says, you're not going. I said, I have got to go. He said, please don't go. And he started praying. I said, the Lord's going to take care of me, and I have got to go. So I went up there, and there she was. And she's getting ready to do the CT, and she's a little nervous. And they gave her a Xanax and everything. And I went down with her and waited and came back and sat there a little bit. And they got her on pure liquid diet. And they think she's got blocked bowels or a hernia in the top of her stomach. She's in congestive heart failure. She's got COPD, and she's got all these things. And I wanted to show her that I was all right, because I just got out of the hospital the day before to show her what God had done for me. And as I was leaving the room, I told her, I said, Sue, I said, always remember that. Prayer first, not last.
Amen.
Don't go to God last. You go to Him first. And she said, okay, Jiggers, nickname. I remember that, and I just love the Lord with all my heart, and I can't wait to get here. And, you know, Bob's not been feeling well. He's weakening down. But, you know, I see God stirring in Bob. And, matter of fact, he witnessed to Howard the other day, and I was amazed. And I said, Bob, you know, the children are watching you. Everybody's watching. I'll give you an example. I went over to the thrift store. And I go in there, and the first thing I get is prayer from Shirley. Me and her pray. Well, I parked on a parking lot, Biscuit World. And I went on over there. I thought, well, if I parked on their lot, because I usually ask if I can, they say I can't. I got to go in there and eat. So I went there, and I always get the same thing, a biscuit and sausage. Well, the doctor says they got high cholesterol. Well, maybe better not do that. So I ordered a cup of coffee and a hamburger. Went back there and sat. There was this gentleman back there sitting. There's one this way, one this way, and he was back this way. And I love to sit by a window and eat. I just love to look out the window when I'm eating. So I sat down there, and there was a television up here to the right. And matter of fact, what was on was Create, like you make things and stuff, and I usually watch it at home. And there was no sound. The man down here at the end looked at me, and he said, well, there's a flipper over, if you'll go get it. And I got up and walked over and looked. And I said, well, I don't see it. He said, well, they could have probably put it somewhere else. I said, probably they could. So I sat back down, and he continued to just sit there, and a little bit later, they came and brought my hamburger. And so I bowed my head and thanked God, you know, for it and the strength to eat it and the hands that prepared it. I looked up, that man looked at me, and he said, praise the Lord, sister. I looked at him, and he said, so very few people do that.
Yeah.
And I said, I'm not ashamed of my Jesus.
Amen.
I said, I love him with all my heart. I said, if I can't go, he can't go. If he can't go, I can't go. I said, that's just the way it is. Then he started witnessing. He was an elderly man. I'll never forget him. Blue, soft eyes, soft, just soft to talk to him in his voice. Because I don't usually talk to people. He kept talking about going to different churches, and I guess I assumed that he lost his way. He didn't say, but he was talking about they always went to churches, to different churches. And he said, somebody asked me one day, said, why do you go to the mountain mission? Why do you go clear up the Elfview? Why do you? The man smote his chest over his heart.
Yeah.
Well, tears come in my eyes. I know. And so finally continued to talk a little bit, and he had a piece of bread in his hand, and what was it in the bowl? I have no idea. The man never did take a drink. I mean, take a bite of that bread. And so I finished, and we talked about the Lord and everything, and I got happy, he got happy. And I got finished, put my stuff up, and I walked over to the man, and I shook his hand. And I said, sir, thank you. And I said, if I don't see you again, I said, I'll see you in heaven. He said, hallelujah! Right there, biscuit through the world. So that was such a blessing for me. So you all just break me, I'll let my light shine.
Amen.
We sing 83 in the Moss Club.
Things and we have so many blessings at our house.
Yeah.
And my sister said to Roger the other day, you guys are so lucky. Well, it doesn't have anything to do with luck.
That's
Amen.
Right. Bless the Lord.
It's not luck. It's God.
God
is
right.
And faith.
And I hope that I can show that to people so God can see that it's not nothing to do with us. It's not luck. It's not anything
Amen.
You're doing. It's God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes, Lord. I was watching... what's that preacher's name comes on Sunday mornings?
Calvin Evans.
Last Sunday. And last Sunday, I'll tell you what, I was watching that and tears come by as he was talking about faith.
Yeah.
You know, he said he had a son that I guess was born ill or something, and he was at the hospital in Columbus several years ago. And the bill was going to, they had to have certain treatments. The bill was going to be between $10,000 and $15,000 a month. He said, I'm just making $145 a week. How am I going to do this? Well, at the same time, there was a woman that worked in the office. She said she was in her office praying. And she seen Jesus standing there. Jesus said, you need to go out. And she was telling Calvin Evans later, she was out looking for this man, and he went to go get on the elevator, and there was this woman standing there. It was that woman, and said, you're the man I've been looking for.
Yeah.
So I've been looking on this elevator for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Said, you've got a son that's sick.
Bless the Lord.
He said, yeah. So they got to talking and stuff, and the woman said, every month when you get your bill, bring it to me. Ask for me and me only. So he started doing that every month. She'd go in there and she'd stamp paid in full.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
You know? How are you doing that? Well, what's being taken care of?
Amen.
You know, and it was faith. It's faith in God. You've got to have faith. It's like Maria was saying about her sister. You know, how do you have good things happen to you? It's not you know, God takes care of us.
Amen.
We don't live in a big fancy mansion here. You know, we don't need no fancy mansion here. You know? We have what we need. Not what we want, necessarily, but what we need. Food, roof over our heads, it's faith.
That's right.
And how can people drive up and down the road on a Sunday morning, probably coming from the bar or whatever, it's hard to tell, but you know, you got to have faith if you want good things to happen to you.
Bless the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to sing this song. You know, after that song that Pastor... boy, play there, although it's just to glorify God, you know. You can glorify God in a song, you glorify God through the word, through a testimony. There's many ways of glorifying God. As the world looks upon me, as I struggle along, they say, to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new, and I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you, and to me, that's all that matters, though the world cannot see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings.
all the victory. Amen. Amen.
That's right.
I've heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I've heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he loved me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I've heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, "Dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit." And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He wants me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I've heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I've heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he loved me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I've got a name. yonder, we will nevermore wander, but walk the streets that are pure as gold.
Amen.
Bless the Lord.
Well, I want to thank the Lord.
Bless you, Charlie.
Give me the opportunity to come out and be at his house. Amen. And be with you fine people.
Bless you, brother.
Bless you, Bob.
Love every little one of you. And I just love to come out and serve by Jesus.
Yeah. Amen.
And I want all your prayers. Gail here, she sure started taking singing lessons. So just pray for her that she will do that.
Bless you, brother.
Well, I was going to say about her voice.
Amen.
She sounds, I hear some Loretta Lynn.
Loretta Lynn, yes.
That's no joke. I said, wow, she got a pretty voice.
But you know what? God don't care what we sound like.
It's not for the image. He gives the glory. That's right. That's what it's all about.
Yeah, that's right.
I even put my 2 cents worth in. I can't play radio, let alone.
God don't leave anybody out.
That's right.
Anybody
sit down and do nothing. Amen. Amen. Let's
go ahead and teach you to come up. Don't come up here. You want to come up here? Come here and sit. Tommy, you want to come up here and sit?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so we've been talking about growing in worship. What is one reason why we should worship Jesus? Why should we worship Jesus?
So we can go to heaven.
Okay. But he was born, he came here for our salvation. He came to save us. Remember our memory verse? Let's read over it, and then we'll see if we've got it memorized yet, okay?
21.
And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Okay, see if we can say it without looking.
Matthew 1:21. And
he
shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins.
Good job. Okay. What's one way that we can worship God? We talked about last week. What's one way we can worship God? If we're obedient to Him, that's a way to worship God. Remember how Joseph was going to divorce Mary, and the angel came to him in a dream and told him to go ahead and marry her, because what was conceived in her was of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And he was obedient, so he married her, because he trusted God and he was obedient. All right. Well, now we're going to look at another reason why we should worship Jesus. Now, we're going to turn our Bibles to Exodus chapter 12. We'll start at verse 21. What's going on here is God is preparing to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt, because they're in slavery. They're enslaved in Egypt. The Egyptians didn't worship God. They worshipped idols. God was preparing to go through Egypt one night, and he was going to smite or kill the firstborn everywhere. The firstborn of all the people, the firstborn of the animals. He was going to smite every firstborn. He was showing Pharaoh his power. He gave the Israelites a way to escape this. He gave them a choice that they could make that would keep them safe, where he wouldn't come in and destroy the firstborn in their house. Okay, and we're going to read Exodus chapter 12. And start. I'm going to read verse 21, and then I'm going to give you to a verse to read. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover. Okay, now this is Moses talking to the elders of Israel. And he's given them the instructions that God had given him. And God, when he told him this, he said to, back in verse 5, he said that your lamb shall be without blemish. Okay, does anybody know what a blemish is?
A spot.
Any imperfection. This lamb had to be perfect. He could not have a blemish at all. I'll get a little spot on my face, and I'll call that as a blemish. That's it's just a tiny spot. You may not even notice it, but I notice it, and it's a blemish. It's an imperfection. I've got all kinds of imperfections. We all have all kinds of imperfections. All right. But a blemish is an imperfection. This lamb is supposed to be without blemish. It has to be perfect. Okay, Autumn, I want you to read verse 22.
And ye shall take a bunch of
hyssop.
Hyssop, and dip it in the blood that is in the
basin.
Basin.
You read verse 23.
For the Lord, I will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he saith the blood upon the
lintel,
and on the two sides,
so what they were supposed to do is they were to kill this perfect lamb without blemish. They were to kill that lamb, and they were to take hyssop, like a plant, and they were supposed to dip it in the lamb's blood and put it on their doors, and that way when the Lord came, when he was coming by, he would see that blood on the doorposts, and he would keep going. He would pass on by. Amen. He would pass over them. What kind of animal were the people supposed to use in this scripture? What was the animal that they were supposed to kill?
Lamb.
A lamb. Was it just an ordinary lamb?
No.
What kind of lamb was it supposed to be?
A lamb without blemish.
Without blemish, a perfect lamb. after they killed the lamb, what were they supposed to put on the doorposts?
Blood.
Then the Lord would pass over the door and would not
smite
the firstborn. Right. Well, today, God looks for a lamb's blood on our hearts, okay? I want us to think about our body as being a house, so we have a doorpost. So your heart is your doorpost. And we need a lamb's blood on our heart. Who is our lamb? Does anybody know? Jesus. Jesus was a perfect lamb. He was without spot or blemish.
Amen.
He never sinned. He was perfect. And we need, what makes us imperfect? We're all imperfect. What makes us imperfect? One little tiny word, but it makes us all imperfect.
Sin.
Sin. Sin is what, if we sin, that's a blemish on us. And so we're not perfect. So we need the blood of a perfect lamb to cover our hearts. And God will pass over us. He won't suffer the destroyer to come in and smite us. And we need, and that perfect lamb is Jesus.
Amen.
So we turn in 1 Peter chapter 1. First Peter chapter 1. So when you ask God to save you, your Jesus' blood is on your doorpost.
Praise God.
You're putting Jesus' blood, that perfect lamb's blood, on your doorpost. Peter chapter 1, verse 18. Okay. I'm going to read this. What? Are you in chapter 1? Yes. Yep. All right. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. So we should worship Jesus because he's the perfect Lamb of God. He had no spot or blemish. We should worship Jesus because he's perfect. Because none of us could be perfect. And I'm thankful that he never sinned. I'm
Amen.
Thankful that he
Amen.
Never had a spot or blemish. You know, he was tempted in all ways as we are. God didn't just put him here and he, you know, sinned. He was never tempted. He was tempted. He was tempted in all ways. But he never sinned. He remained without spot or blemish. All right, so you want to go, let's go over the memory verse one more time. Matthew 1:21.
And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall
save his people from their sins. Okay, let's do it again. Let's read it.
Matthew 1:21, she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins.
Matthew 1:21,
and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins.
Good job. As you say. You want to go up there and sing with the kids? You don't want to sing? You just want to watch? Okay. You want to come up and sing, Tommy? He looked at me like I had plants growing out of my ears. Do what?
He's going to grow carrots.
Are you growing carrots?
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts and Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st John, 2nd John, 3rd John, Jude and Revelation.
Do you know Jesus loves me? No. Jesus loves me? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones don't belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Oh, they tell me of a home far beyond the skies. Oh, they tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me of a home where my friends have gone. Oh, they tell me of that land far away, where the tree of life in eternal bloom sheds its fragrance through the unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me of the King in his beauty there. And they tell me that mine eyes shall be
Praise the Lord. I'm thankful Now to know, the Bible says that eye hath not seen and ear hath not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him.
Amen.
But it doesn't stop there. Amen. Aren't you glad that the Bible doesn't just stop there? It goes on and it says, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit.
Hallelujah.
For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. Hallelujah. If you want to know what heaven's going to be like, dig into the Word of God.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. You'll find, amen, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. Brother, we got a lot to look forward to.
Amen.
The carnal man doesn't receive the things of God. They're foolishness unto him.
Yeah.
They can't be discerned by the carnal mind. It's the Spirit of God,
hallelujah,
amen, that shows us the things of God. Oh, aren't you glad, hallelujah,
amen,
to be partakers of his Spirit. Turn with me, if you would, to Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, chapter 43. I love the book of Isaiah, amen. And I'm thankful, amen, for this scripture that we're about to read. And, you know, it's a blessing to know what we're here for.
Amen.
It's a blessing, you know, everybody wonders this. Everybody wonders, what is the purpose of life? What are we here for? What are we in this world for? This scripture that we're getting ready to read, it answers that question.
Yes, Lord.
It answers that question in wonderful detail, why God has made us. There is a purpose for each and every one of you here today. God has a purpose for you. Amen. You may not feel like you have a purpose in this world, but God says you have a purpose. And amen, that's what we're going to read. The Bible says here in the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, beginning at verse 1, but now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name, thou art mine. I tell you, that's enough to make you shout.
Amen.
Because God knows your name.
Amen.
Amen. That's exciting to me to know that God knows my name. There's a lot of people that are in this world that are men of renown, men of respect, that men of power in this world, that, brother, they have no idea who I am. They have no idea who you are. But I tell you, the King of Kings,
amen,
and the Lord of Lords, amen, one day he called my name. One day he called your name, amen, and you heard his voice, amen. And glory be to God, you answered him. And hallelujah, isn't it good to know he knows your name. The Bible says, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. God didn't say, if you go through the waters, I'll be with you. God didn't say, if the rivers are there and they overflow, that I'll be with you. He didn't say, if you go through the fire, it won't kindle. He said, when.
Hallelujah.
When you go through it, I'll be with you.
Yes,
amen. Isn't it good to know that God's there with, amen, you when you go through it? Hallelujah. He says, for I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee, since thou wast precious in my sight. Thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore will I give men for thee and people for thy life. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east and gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from far and my daughters from the ends of the earth, everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. Let's all go to the throne of God. Father Almighty, we praise you, my heavenly Father. Lord, we thank you, dear Lord God, that you are sovereign, Father God. Lord, that there is none like you. Father God, that you share not your glory with another, Father. Lord God, we praise you, Father God. Lord, that you have made us, Father, in your own image. We praise you, heavenly Father God. Lord, for the Spirit that you've given us through Jesus. Oh, the promise, dear Lord God, that you've given us, dear Lord. And Father, we praise you this morning. And we ask you, Father, that you anoint my lips. Hide me behind the cross, Father God. Lord, that you might Feed these your sheep and help us, dear Lord God, to understand the purpose, dear Lord, that you have created us for. And Father, I give you all the praise and all the glory and honor, Father, in Jesus' name. And amen.
Amen.
The word says right here in the last scripture that we read in verse 7, everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. Amen. God made you to glorify him. That is exactly what you were created for. God made you to give him glory. You say, well, Brother Troy, how do I give God glory? How is it possible to give God glory? Well, I'll tell you how God, how Paul gave glory. God, Paul gave God glory by him taking a sinner that was the chiefest of sinners and making him a saint, taking him and making him the apostle Paul, amen, that wrote two-thirds of the New. That gives God glory. It shows God's power, amen, when God takes somebody that is a lost sheep and makes them, glory be to God, a part of the fold of God. Hallelujah, that is what God, that God gets glory from your infirmities when God changes you and makes you a new creature in him. God receives glory for that. The world sees it and the world marvels at the things of God. When God, when they see that God does these things in you. You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10 and 31, whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. That's everything.
Amen.
Whatever you do, you say, Brother Troy, I can't do that. You're exactly right. You can't. You cannot do that. But I tell you of a man who can, amen, Jesus can do it through you. If the glory be to God, he says, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Brother, if Jesus is going to do anything today, he's going to do it through you.
Amen.
He's going to work through you with the Holy Spirit of God, the glory that filled the tabernacle in the wilderness, the glory that filled Solomon's temple, that same glory indwells you and it works through you.
Amen.
Unto him that's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or even think, according to the power that worketh in us.
Yes.
To him be the glory.
Hallelujah.
Amen. That word power, it's the Greek word dynamis. It's where we get the word dynamite from. Amen. God's dynamite will work through you. Amen. To accomplish much. Oh, I'm glad. Hallelujah. God has made us for his glory.
Amen.
Let me ask you a question. How do we please God? If we're going to glorify God, how do we please God? And let me ask you another question. Do you please God? When you think on God and you think about how sovereign and how holy and how righteous and how perfect he is, brother, just as the Lord taught us, he is without spot and without blemish. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. I'm glad that he didn't just stay in heaven. I'm so glad that he became a man, that the Word became flesh, and we beheld his glory. The glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. I'm glad, amen, that he tabernacled. He came to this earth and took on the form of a man and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The Bible says, wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. I'm so glad that God did that. But brother, glory be to God, how do we please him who is ever so perfect, who is ever so holy? The Bible said in Isaiah 6 that when he saw the Lord high and lifted up, his train filled the temple. He said that the seraphims were on one side and the other, and they cried one to another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. How can you please such a perfect and precious Savior? Let me ask you, do you please him? Amen. Do you please God by not sinning? Well, God doesn't want anyone to sin. Amen. God, the Bible says he's angry with the wicked every day.
Amen.
God hates sin so much that he let them crucify his son. That's how much God hates sin. Yes, sir, God hates sin. God, the Bible says in Romans chapter 6, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. I'm so glad he came to save sinners. But I'm so glad that he didn't leave me a sinner. I'm so glad that he didn't leave me to continue living the same way in the filth and the muck and the mire. Oh, as the psalmist wrote, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my foot upon a rock and hath established my goal. He didn't leave you in the pit. He brought you up out of that pit. And he set you upon a rock. Oh, glory be to God. How Jesus said, as the children sang there just a minute ago, he said, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man that built his house upon a rock. Amen. Jesus is that rock of our salvation. Amen. I'm so glad that he didn't just leave us in that same misery and woe and sinful state. But brother, do we please God by simply not sinning? Look with me, if you would, at Matthew chapter 19. The Bible says that there was a rich young ruler, and he came to Jesus, and he asked Jesus. He said, good master, what good thing must I do to inherit eternal life? In verse 16. And Jesus said, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one. That is God. Amen. Aren't you glad that God is the only good
Amen.
One? Hallelujah. Amen. You know, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that we can attain to his holiness. Aren't you glad?
Amen.
Aren't you glad you're not trusting in what you can do?
Yes.
Amen. Right. Hallelujah. But the rich young ruler, he says, saith unto him, he says, but if thou wilt enter into life, in verse 17, keep the commandments. And he saith unto him, which? And Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The young man saith unto him, all these things have I kept from my youth up. What lack I yet? Brother, if you look at those commandments, and you look at the tablets that Moses came down from Mount Sinai with, on one side of those tablets, brother, the first five commandments were commandments towards God. I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt have no other God before me. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy to the thousands that love me. Brother, that's the first and the great commandment. But all these commandments that Jesus talked to him about was commandments toward his fellow man. These were commandments toward mankind. These were commandments that were between him and his neighbor, to him and his brothers. But the commandments of God, what about the commandments of God? You might be a good person, and you do your neighbor no harm. And you don't, brother, you don't sin towards your neighbor. You don't covet anything your neighbor has. You haven't murdered your neighbor. You don't bear false witness against your neighbor. But what about God? How do you please God? Hallelujah. There's only one way you can please God. You cannot please God. Listen to me this morning. You do not please God by simply not sinning. That's the point I'm trying to make. You do not glorify God by simply not sinning. This man here, the Bible says, the young man saith unto him, all these things have I kept from my youth up. What like I yet? If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast and give to the poor. Then thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. Jesus was trying to get him to see that he couldn't be perfect by the law.
Amen.
It's impossible.
Amen.
You cannot be perfect by not sinning. Did you hear me? You cannot be justified. Hallelujah. Makes me want to shout and dance and sing. You cannot be justified by not sinning. Glory be to God. God doesn't want you to sin. Don't get me wrong. But you are not justified by not sinning. You're not justified by not drinking. You're not justified by not smoking dope. You're not justified by not committing adultery. You are not justified by not doing those things. There's only one way that the just lives.
Amen. By faith.
By faith, sister. Bless your heart and soul. The just shall live by faith. Faith. Amen. As my brother testified, that is the only single way that you can please God.
Amen.
You can't please God any other way. Any other way. I'm so glad for that. Hallelujah. Do you want to please Him?
Amen.
I want to please Him. Amen. I want to please Him, brother, because He is worthy.
Amen.
That word of worship, the root word of the word worship, is worthy.
Amen.
God is worthy of our worship. He is worthy to be praised. He is worthy. Glory be to God. I'm so glad, amen, that there's only one way to please God. It makes it simple for somebody like me. I like simple things.
Bless the Lord.
Amen. I don't like to be confused. You know, the devil's the author of confusion.
Amen.
I don't like to be confused. The Bible said that David, in Psalm 19, he said, "Lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies." Even Paul said that but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve, that your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ.
Yes.
I'm so glad that it's so simple.
Amen.
That a man, though a wayfaring fool, shall not err therein.
Amen.
Aren't you glad? Hallelujah. Amen. Aren't you glad, amen, that He makes it simple? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, if you would look with me there, Hebrews chapter 11, the chapter of faith. You want to read of some great faith in the Bible?
Yes,
read
the
Hebrews
Lord.
Chapter 11. Oh, hallelujah. You could spend days, weeks, and months just reading through Hebrews. You can read there in Hebrews 11, and you get to one of them Old Testament patriarchs of faith and say, well, hallelujah, I want to go back in the Old Testament. I want to read that over again. And then you get back to Hebrews 11, and you start reading some. Well, hallelujah, I want to go back and read some about that one there. I want to read about Jephthah, and I want to read about Barak, and I want to read about those things, those Old Testament saints of faith. I want to see how their faith was exemplified.
Amen,
in this world. It excites me, amen. Because you know what? Those folks that died in faith, it says in this very same chapter, they didn't receive Jesus. Jesus hadn't came yet.
Amen.
Brother, they were looking ahead by faith.
Yes.
They didn't receive the promise of the Holy Spirit, but they reached ahead by faith.
Amen.
And were justified by faith.
Praise God.
By faith. Verse 5, the Bible says, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death. What's that mean? Brother, that means he was raptured.
Hallelujah.
Brother, folks want to argue about simple doctrinal things in the Bible. And you know what the Bible says? That there shouldn't be contention
amen.
In the word of God.
Amen.
The servant of the Lord must not strive.
Amen.
But be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient. In meekness instructing those that oppose themselves, if by peradventure they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. You know those contentions and things that go on over doctrine? The devil's he's putting a snare out there.
That's right.
And he's trying, you know what the Bible told me, Brother Jim, in Psalm 91? Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory be to God. I'm so glad, amen, that God does not want us to strive over the word.
That's right.
Amen. He wants us to contend for faith.
Amen.
Amen. He said, earnestly contend for the faith, which was once delivered to the saints in the book of Jude. That's what he says. So, brother, in other words, God tells us that He wants us to hang on, to trust faith. Now, some don't believe in the rapture. And, brother, glory be to God, I'm so thankful to be looking forward to the blessed hope.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I'm so glad that I'm not just left. I don't just have a hope. I got a blessed
hallelujah.
Hope. I'm looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God
hallelujah.
And my Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's what I'm looking forward
praise
to.
God.
Enoch was translated. The Bible says that he walked with God,
amen.
And then he was not,
amen.
For God took him.
Hallelujah.
All of a sudden, he was gone.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Boy, glory be to God. I'm excited
amen.
About what's going to happen.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward.
Yes.
I'm looking forward to being translated. By faith, Enoch was translated, that he should not see death and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God.
Amen.
Amen. You have that testimony this morning? It's good to have that testimony. You know what, brother? The joy of the Lord is our strength. It excites me that no matter what this world might think about me, no matter what the devil thinks about me, brother, it's big, oh, hallelujah. It stirs my soul, amen. Knowing that there's only one that I got to please. There's only one, hallelujah, that I have to, my heart has to be at peace with, and it's God Almighty. That's the only one I need to be concerned. That's the only one you need to be concerned about. Everybody gets so caught up in what everybody else thinks, but I tell you, you just need to have faith in God and let and please God. That's all. That's brother, it makes it easy. It makes it simple. But without faith in verse 6, but without faith, it is impossible to please Him. That's why I say you can't please God no other way. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him.
That's right.
For he that cometh to God must believe that He is.
Hallelujah.
And that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Brother, that is a blessing. The Bible tells us right there that God is. You know, the Bible said that He talked to Moses there in Exodus chapter 3 from the burning bush. That's a blessing to me, brother, to think about how that Moses was a murderer. That Moses had been raised in the house of Pharaoh. That Moses had something down inside of him. Amen. That God saw. That amen that Moses couldn't see for himself. And glory be to God. The Bible said that when he saw that burning bush, that he said, take off your shoes for you're standing on holy ground.
Yes, he did.
And glory be to God, you know what? Moses obeyed.
Amen.
And I'm so glad, amen, for his obedience. Moses said, God told him that he was to go before Pharaoh. Pharaoh, the king of all of Egypt, the greatest land in the world in that time. It was the greatest land and country in that time. That he was to go before him and he was going to tell him, let my people go. Let my people go. Let them go. And glory be to God. He said, well, I can't go before him. How am I supposed to? Who am I to tell them sent me? Who am I to tell the people sent me? The Bible said, Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and then shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am.
Hallelujah.
And he said, thus shalt thou say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you. Yes. He is. Mm-hmm. He is. I'm glad it's not he was.
Hallelujah.
It's he is. Amen. Hallelujah. God is not the God of the dead, but God of the living. Amen. I'm so glad that when Jesus came to his disciples and he says, who do men say that I am? And glory be to God. They said, some say that thou art Elijah, and some say that you're John the Baptist risen from the dead. And he looked at Peter and he said, but who do ye say that I am? And Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah. He said, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father, which is in heaven. Oh, glory be to God. He said, you're the Son of the living God. I'm so glad to serve the living God. You know all these other gods, brother? There's tombs. You can go and you can find Muhammad, or you can go and you can find Buddha. You can go and find these different ones where they've been buried in different things. But glory be to God, you go to where Jesus is, what was. And brother, when they went and they looked in his tomb, the tomb was empty, brother, because he rose. He conquered death and hell and the grave. He said, I am he that was dead and am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and hell.
Hallelujah.
Jesus rose, brother.
Amen.
He's the living God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
He said, I am. Jesus is what you need him to be.
Yes.
He that cometh to God must believe that he is.
Amen.
Brother, when you come to him, the Bible says that therefore let us come boldly under the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Brother, when you come to God, you need to believe that God is the answer for whatever you're coming to Him for. Whatever. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Amen. There's not God can do all things. With men, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. God is everything that you need Him to be. He'll be the very words in your mouth in the presence of Pharaoh.
That's right.
He'll be your Passover lamb to protect you from the destroyer. Hallelujah. He'll be the rod of God in your hands that part the waters of the Red Sea. He'll be a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Glory be to God. He'll even be a donkey that you ride on that'll turn around and talk to you. Brother, he'll be the scarlet thread that you hang outside of your window. And when all the walls come falling down around you, your house is the only one that stands. And your family is the only ones that are saved. Glory be to God. He'll be your strength. He'll be the jawbone of an ass that slays thousands. Amen. Glory be to God. He'll be the oil that's poured out upon your head and anoints you king. Hallelujah. He'll be the rock that goes from your sling and slays the giant. Glory be to God. He'll be a lump of figs that the prophet puts on you on a boil of cancer, and that you're healed by. Amen. He'll be the glory that fills your temple. Brother, he'll be the joy of the Lord to you. He'll be the walls around your city in the book of Nehemiah. Brother, he'll be the gallows that hang your enemy as they hung Mordecai. Brother, he'll be the daysman between you and the heavenly Father as he was for Job. Job said, I would that there was a daysman betwixt us. Amen. He'll be your mediator to God Almighty. I tell you, we have one mediator. Glory be to God. That is the man. There's one mediator between God and man. That is the man, Christ Jesus. Amen. I'm so glad, hallelujah, to have an advocate with the Father. I'm so glad that I don't go to him in my righteousness, but that I can go to God in the righteousness of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. When he raised Lazarus from the grave.
Amen. Amen.
He'll be your wisdom.
Yes.
In the book of Proverbs.
You,
he'll be the preacher in the book of Ecclesiastes.
Yes.
He'll be my beloved in the book of Song of Solomon. He'll be the lily of your valley. He'll be the rose of Sharon. Brother, the Bible says in Isaiah that his name is wonderful. He'll be your counselor. He's the mighty God. He's the everlasting Father. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the fire shut up in your bones. Hallelujah. That you don't give up. He'll be the rock, the hammer that breaketh the rock into pieces as he was to He'll be the compassion that you need in the book of Lamentations.
Yes.
In the book of Ezekiel.
Yes.
He'll be the man with the inkhorn that writes your name down in the Lamb's book of life.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm so glad that, brother, that they rejoice in heaven over one sinner that repents, because the name is written down in the Lamb's book of life.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Hallelujah. He'll be the fourth man in the fire.
Yeah.
He'll be with you there when you go through that trial. Brother, in the book of Hosea, he'll show the epitome of mercy and grace and unfavored, unmerited favor in the book of Hosea as a husband that shows long suffering to an adulterous wife. That is my Savior. That is my Jesus. That is what he has done for his people. I'm so glad for who he is. What do you need him to be this morning? I tell you, he's the bread of life. He's the living water. He's the light of the world. He's the door of the sheep. He is the good shepherd. Amen. He is the resurrection. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the true vine. There's no limit to what he can be.
That's right.
Amen.
There's no limit to him. He can be whatever you need him to be. He that cometh to God must believe that he is.
Okay.
And that he is a rewarder. You know God loves to give gifts.
Bless the Lord.
You know what the devil gives? He pays wages. Mm-hmm. The wages of sin is death.
Yes.
But the gift of God is eternal life.
Amen.
God loves to give gifts.
That's true.
He is a gift giver. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. If you had a son that came and asked you a fish, would you give him a serpent? If he asked you for a loaf of bread, would you give him a stone? If ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give good things to them that ask him? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us willingly, how shall he not also with him freely give us all things? The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8, what is some problem, some little thing that we struggle with? It's nothing compared to God.
Amen.
It's nothing compared to what he has already given us.
Yes.
I'm so glad that he is all these things. There's no limit to what he can do.
That's right.
Brother, even though there's things all around us, things all around us that try to destroy our faith, that try to shipwreck our faith, we walk not by sight, but by faith. We don't walk by sight. Hallelujah. The blinder I get, the better I can see.
Amen.
Amen. The blinder I get to this world,
true,
the better I can see.
Amen.
Oh, that blind man that Jesus healed in John chapter 9, he didn't know a whole lot. He said, they said, we know that this man's a sinner. Give God the glory, they said to him. And he said, whether he be a sinner, I know not. He said, but one thing I know, I was blind, but now I can see.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Yes. Brother, that's all I know. His brother, I used to be a sinner, but now I'm a saint. I used to be a filthy and covered in the slop of this world, but God's cleaned me up and he set my foot upon a rock.
Amen.
He's clothed me in the robe of his righteousness.
That's right. Thank you.
Oh, it's a blessing, brother. Faith is believing the promise in the Word of God.
Amen.
It's believing what God has promised you.
Amen.
You know, all the promises of God in Christ Jesus are yea and amen.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Every one of them. There isn't one promise that God goes back on. Brother, he will fulfill his good word.
Amen.
He will fulfill it. Brother, you might not see how whatever you're dealing with is possible. You may not be able to see it. It may seem completely impossible, and you have no idea how it's going to happen. You have no idea how things are going to turn out.
That's true.
You know what? God does not want you to know. We need to glorify God that you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Take no thought for the morrow. For the morrow shall take thought for things of itself.
Amen.
Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. He says, don't worry about tomorrow.
Amen.
Don't worry about it.
Bless the Lord.
Amen. All these things the Gentiles seek after is what the Bible says.
That's right.
It says, but seek ye first the righteousness of God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Seek those things. Seek the right. How do you become righteous? By faith.
Amen.
Have faith in God.
Bless the Lord.
That is the only way that you're righteous. Mm-hmm. You are not righteous any other way. I'm so glad he made it like that.
Amen.
Even though you may not know what will happen, even though, brother, that there may be compelling evidence to the contrary, it doesn't take faith if you know what's going to happen. It doesn't take faith, brother, to build a church upon the rock, amen, when, glory be to God, there's already one established. That's what he told Peter. He said, upon this rock will I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against. Peter probably said, what's a church?
That's right.
What's a church? I never heard of that, but I've heard of the synagogue and things. What's a church? Jesus said, I'll build it. And he says, and the gates of hell won't prevail against it.
That's right.
And our brother, glory be to God, he couldn't see it. He didn't know how it was possible, but oh, glory to God, on the 50 days after the Passover, brother, the Bible said that there came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind, and brother, they began to speak in tongues, and every man heard them in their own language, and glory be to God, 3,000 souls were saved in a day. In a day, God did that. God can take you from being a pauper to a prince in a day. In a moment.
Bless the Lord.
He can take you from a hallelujah. He can take you from a corruptible hallelujah. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must be put on immortality. Then the saying that is written shall be brought to pass, that death is swallowed up in victory. He'll take you from corruptible and make you incorruptible.
Amen.
He'll take you from mortal and make you immortal.
That's right.
In a moment. That's what he did that day. How does it happen? By faith. Brother, the more that sinners and the people around you, those that know not the word of God nor the will of God, try to discourage you from what God has promised you, you can be sure you're on the right track.
Amen.
You can be sure you're on the right track when sinners are trying to discourage you from the will of God. The more they try to discourage you from what God has revealed to you in His Word, you can be sure you're on the right track.
Hallelujah.
Brother, hallelujah, I'm so glad. The more that they try to discourage you, the more that they try to discourage Jesus, the more that Satan tried to get him to question who he was, he just went back to the Word.
Amen.
If you're the Son of God, cast yourself down. If you're the Son of God, command that these stones be made into bread. Jesus just simply went back to the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
And he said, this is what God has said.
Amen.
Jesus could, he said, well, Jesus, if you got faith, cast yourself down from here. It's written. He'll command his angels to bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. That's why it's important that we know the whole counsel of God.
Yes.
Paul said, I have not failed to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. You see, because Jesus could have said, well, he's got a point there. It does say that he'll command his angels to give charge over me and to bear me up in their hands lest I die. He could have questioned it. But brother, he is the Word.
Amen.
He's the author of the Word. Amen. You have the author inside of you.
Amen.
Amen. And the Bible said there that he said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God.
Hallelujah.
The whole counsel of God. Not just one part. Not just a little bit over here. The whole counsel
Amen.
Of God. If you don't know the answer, I guarantee you that if you'll call into him, he'll answer you.
Amen.
And he'll show you great and mighty things
yes.
that you know not. That's how my Jesus is. Romans chapter 4, one last scripture before we close. We look at Romans chapter 4 and we see a great patriarch of faith, which was amazing, amazing to me. The Bible says here in verse 16, therefore it is of faith that it might be grace. To the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. The Bible tells us in Galatians that they that are faith, the same are the children of faithful Abraham, because of faith. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him whom he believed. Even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. Did you know that life and death is in the power of the tongue?
Amen.
And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof.
Amen.
Brother, the enemy might put thoughts in your head. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness. Those are the things, and so these thoughts may come into your head, but that doesn't mean you have to say it.
Amen.
You don't have to say everything that comes into your head. Your heart is deceitful above all things. Don't let it deceive you to say it, because when you say it, you are a child of the living God.
Amen.
And you command things to happen.
Amen.
When you say it.
Blessing the Lord.
Life and death is in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. God is not mocked.
Amen.
For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap.
Amen.
Whether of flesh unto destruction or of life everlasting. Brother, either you can sow the things that are good.
Hallelujah.
He satisfies your mouth with good things.
Amen.
So that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Yeah. Amen. That's Psalms 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says that God calls those things that are not as though they were.
Yes, thank you.
Before this world was even created, he formed the world of things that were not seen in Hebrews 11. God took the atoms that we can't even see and formed worlds, stars,
Amen.
Moons, sun. Atoms that we can't even see. The things that are made by the things that do not appear. God formed all of these things. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God. He caused those things that be not as though they were. He told Abraham, he said that in thy seed shall all nations be blessed. He didn't say seeds. He said seed, which is one that is Christ. That's what the book of Galatians says. He didn't say seeds, meaning many people. He didn't say seeds, meaning, well, just this race of people, just the Hebrew people. He said seed, which is one that is Christ. That is the only way we can please God is through the seed, which is Jesus. Who against hope believed in hope, verse 18, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He didn't say, well, man, I'm 100 years old. It's impossible. He wasn't weak in faith. He said, glory be to God. My God is an awesome God.
Hallelujah.
He's going to show his power in my weakness. He's going to show his glory. He's going to be glorified through my faith.
Yes,
Lord.
He's going to be glorified through my faith. You know that faith speaks?
Amen.
Oh yeah. Faith speaks. The Bible says that the blood of Christ speaks better things than that of Abel's blood. Faith will speak, brother. Brother, I believed, therefore have I spoken. Hallelujah. It's out of the heart, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Amen. Brother, if you got wickedness in your heart, and you speak evil, brother, you got evil in your heart.
Bless him, Lord.
And you need to get on the altar
Amen.
Of God.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
And you need to give it to God because he is. And he is a rewarder of them that diligently
Amen.
Seek him.
Yes, Lord.
Give it to God. God will satisfy our mouths with good things. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but is strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised he was able also to perform. Therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Now, it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification.
Yeah.
I'm so glad that God doesn't just want us to have a belief. You can believe all kinds of things in this world. You can believe the sky's green, but you're wrong. It's blue, brother. You're colorblind. It's blue.
Bless the Lord.
And you can believe all kinds of things. But glory be to God, the belief. He said, God so loved the world that he gave his
Amen.
Only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. That means burn in the devil's hell for eternity, but have everlasting life.
Yes.
Everlasting life in heaven.
God.
You want to go to heaven
God.
And be with God Almighty?
Amen.
You want to go and be with him forever?
Yes.
Hallelujah. That's the promise of God.
Amen.
Amen. That's the promise. But to believe, brother, to just simply have a knowledge of something, brother, that's not faith. Faith is when you take your belief and you put it in action.
Amen.
That's having faith. Mm-hmm. To have faith, to put your faith into action. You say, well, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and I want to be saved. Well, then you come to Jesus. You don't come to me because I can't save you. I can't even save myself. But you come to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And you say, Jesus, save me.
Yes.
You're struggling with something in your home. You're struggling with something in your job. You're struggling with a marriage. You're struggling with a relationship. You're struggling with a neighbor. Brother, God is. He is. I am that I am.
Yes. Amen.
He will be what you need in a time of need.
Hallelujah.
He'll show compassion and mercy.
Amen.
You see, faith without works is dead. To take that faith and to speak it. Amen. Say, my faith is alive.
Amen.
My Savior lives inside of me. It's a blessing for God to put His belief, the faith inside of you into action. And to make things happen. To call things that are not as though they are. Mm-hmm. To say, I don't know how it's going to happen, God, but you do.
Amen.
You've declared the end from the beginning. God, you know all things. And Lord God, would you just help me to have more faith?
Amen.
Help me to practice faith. Help me to glorify you.
Yes,
Lord, that you would receive the glory. Lord, that you would be glorified in my weakness.
Yes. Amen.
If we could get a song of invitation, if anyone here has something on their heart that they need, something that God has shown you, that He has whispered to you in a still, small voice, that you need help with. Maybe you're just a young child and you've never been saved. Maybe you don't know Jesus as your Savior. God is your Savior. Jesus is your Savior. Maybe you're going through a heartache, a trouble, a trial. God is your answer to whatever you need. God is the answer. He is the answer to all problems. He is the Prince of Peace. He is your counselor above all other counselors. He is your healing. He is your deliverer.
Amen.
He is wonderful. He's the mighty God. You can come to Him. You can cast all of your care upon Him.
That's right.
For He cares for you. I'm so glad that it's not just part. It's not a partial salvation. He saves us wholly and completely and gives us everything we need. And I'm so glad He not only gives us things we need, He gives us things that we have desires for.
Amen.
Yes, sir. He certainly does. And I'm so glad that He don't give me things that would hurt me. Because, brother, there's often times that we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Holy Spirit will make intercession for us.
Amen.
With groanings that cannot be uttered.
Yes, Lord.
And He'll go to God on our behalf.
Amen.
Someone have a song of invitation?
In the most, page 273, just as I am.
Amen. Bless the Lord. Aren't you glad that you can't get good enough? Amen. For God to answer your prayer.
Yes, Lord.
That Jesus already fulfilled it all.
Yes.
He finished it on the cross so that you and I could live in victory.
Jesus.
Won't you come this morning?
Just as I am.
Oh, man. Of God I come.
to God Almighty. You know, the priests in the Old Testament, they could only go once a year into the Holy of Holies. And they couldn't go in there just on their own accord, or they would die. But amen, I'm so glad that we can come to God at any time. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden,
amen,
and I will give you rest." Aren't you glad we can rest in Jesus? Amen. Anybody have anything that you want to say? Anything you want to...
Pastor Torrey,
yes, ma'am.
On the second Sunday of the month, we take up a donation.
Oh, yeah.
It'll be next week.
Oh, praise the Lord.
For Israel.
Amen. Yes, ma'am. Thank you for reminding us. Amen. Yes, the Lord put it in our hearts to send that donation over to the folks in Israel there. Amen. The Bible says, God said, "I'll bless those that bless thee, and I'll curse
amen.
Him that curseth thee." So, amen.
I sent last month $635.
Praise the Lord.
Letter back for him on the
table. Praise
the
Lord.
Here sits down
the house. Amen. Amen. All right. Anybody else have anything you want to say for the Lord? All right. You want to come up, buddy, and praise the Lord? Come on up here beside me. All right. This is Russell. He's our buddy. Yes, he's a good fella. All right, raise your arms up like this. Jim, would you lead us?
Praise the Lord for His mercy endureth forever. Praise the Lord for His mercy endureth forever. Praise the Lord for His mercy endureth forever. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Did you have fun this morning?